All right. So my buddy Chris over here, he buys cars from the auction and he buys interesting ones. So I figure, why don't we start doing videos on nostalgic stuff that I'm used to, that I had as a kid or that I've seen growing up as a kid, and we actually analyze these things and talk about them. So this is a Mercury Cougar. What year is it, Chris?
97.
So 97. Now, the reason why this car is special to me and why I wanted to bring this series back is because I used to have a 92 Ford Thunderbird. So it's in the same generation. I had the older body style and a different shape, but at the gist of it, DNA-wise, it's the same car. So I just have a little bit of attachment to it, and when Chris said he bought one, I wanted to check it out immediately. Under the hood, it's the good old 4.6-liter modular motor. Huge, doesn't make a lot of power. I think they're reasonably reliable because in Crown Victorias, they seem to last long. So looking at it, I had the six cylinder, so like mine was like super slow. But looking at it, it is like, compared to a small block Chevy, like in my project truck, it's huge. Like, because you have overhead cams in this thing, so the cylinder heads are much larger compared to a Chevy typical V8. But it's just such a neat car, and we're gonna discuss why. All right, so let's hear from the horse's mouth. Chris, let's do a little tour of the vehicle on the outside before we go underneath it.
So this is the front and the magic system inside that makes noises, and you feed it fuel and...
The engine.
Yeah, it goes, helps the car.
It goes vroom vroom.
Forward and reverse. As you can see, it's got this really nice, I don't know if you can see it in the camera there, but this nice Ford...
Sprinkles.
Sprinkles, yes. It's, that makes it, you know, stand
all right.
out.
All right. I guess you got the license plate in the dash. Yeah, that's smart.
Oh, it's laws here.
It's gangster.
Yeah, it's fine. This is the door. It's big. It's heavy.
See, he slams these doors. I actually like how they sound when he doesn't slam them, but he always slams them for some reason.
Well, you have to slam this one because it's got this, it's a little loose, but it makes you strong. You know? Yeah.
Like, there's gotta be, hold on here. Listen to this. Like, yeah, like, that's like 90s American quality.
I've heard that sound before in the 90s.
It sounds like, Mustangs sound like it too. Oh, quick little thing. So Cougars back in the day shared the same platform as a Mustang, but now the Cougar shares the same platform, or not now, back then in the 90s, shares the same platform as a Thunderbird. So a little interesting tidbit there. Yeah. Can you give us a tour of the interior?
So these are your couches. They're very comfortable.
And this is what we call that cockpit style, because there's like a 15 degree angle on the inside towards the driver. Like, so that way the passenger can't see the controls as well.
And this, you remember, this is the 97, and it has automatic climate control, automatic lights. Oh, yeah. It has quite a bit of features.
And it has a tachometer. My 92 Thunderbird didn't have a tach in it. So uh-huh. I put in a Pioneer DH7000 MP, pretty sure it was the MP, and it would do tach sensing through voltage. So it was an automatic.
Super accurate.
It was an automatic. It didn't matter, but like, I just like having a tach.
Oh, and, of course.
You know, so I put in like a $500 single din stereo back in the day.
That's what you did.
Look at your headliner though. Like it's still perfect. It's attached. Yeah. Like the glue's not coming off.
The sun visor got a little floppy here. That's
okay. It's like feature. It's like Snoopy's ears. Okay.
Hits you in the head, keeps you awake while you drive.
No, it's actually like it. It's not a bad looking interior. Like, so many people give American interiors flack for being plasticky, but what I noticed with plasticky interiors, they look like crap the entire time. They don't get worse.
That's true.
It starts out looking like crap.
And it stays looking like crap.
But like a lot of like BMWs and Volkswagens, you had a Volkswagen,
yeah,
crayon smell.
Yeah.
They flake because they're painted.
Yeah.
And you get a little bit on you every time you get
out. It's like it's just this horrible residue. But like looking at this car, it still looks the same. It goes back to like I had this argument where, not argument, it's my theory. So would you rather date a girl that's like a 7, like forever? Like she's like,
of course.
She's always,
yes.
Or like, let's say like a date girl's like a 6 even. But then, would you rather...
that's kind of my borderline there. 5'7".
Or would you rather date a girl that's like a 10, but when she hits like 30, she turns into like a 4?
No.
Yeah,
no.
See, so...
Because I'm already in my 30s, and I'm a solid 4.
So this thing's basically like a 6 or a 5 out of the gate.
Forever.
But it's still a 6 or a 5.
It still is.
Like... What's a car that would probably be like a 3, but that was kind of like an 8 before? Your Saab?
I don't know. No, that Saab is pretty awesome.
What's a car like that starts out high?
What's a good car that starts?
Maybe like an E-Class, like Mercedes.
No. I think the Neon. Because you remember when the Dodge Neon...
You thought the Neon starts off like an 8.
When it first came out, everyone loved it. Everyone loved it, the bubbly eyes, you know, kind of thing.
Oh, when the car first debuted, like it was new and fresh.
They could not make as many that they were selling. You know, there was you know, that was, what was that, 2000, 99?
No, I think that was kind of like 92 or 90, yeah. No, 95, I thought.
95, yeah. But yeah, that first gen.
I guess you're right. Yeah, like there was a lot of hype behind that car. And then after like, you drive a Neon.
Yeah.
Now that like
they
it has,
don't see them anymore either.
There's no prestige to that car at all.
Yeah. So
here's the interesting thing about these vehicles. So when Ford and Mercury were coming out with it, they were going after the European market. So way back when the Thunderbird came out, they were going after Corvette, and then the Thunderbird started to kind of blow up in size, and now they went back to, or in the 90s, they went back to a more sleek design, and the BMW 3 Series was kind of their target.
I forgot, I want to show.
Oh, okay, what?
So come around here, you gotta come in. Cabin here. Many cars don't have this. It's very important for colder climates. Come swing down here.
Swing down here. Okay, the swing.
Look at this. The crotch warmer blows hot air right onto your bits. Toasty.
Wait. Yeah, no, I'm trying to think. Yeah, they put airbags there so you get sacked now.
What?
That's what they do now.
That's not comfortable.
Yeah, they put air. No, new cars, they put airbags there, I guess, to protect your shins or your knees. So.
What about the important bits?
I don't know.
They should have some sort of airbag system. No.
Okay, here's the part I don't understand. My car had this too.
I don't know. I thought this was broken. But...
Yeah. My car, we had like really good condition. We got like 72,000 kilometers. And you're like, okay, well, here's the release for the seat so I can get in. Every time I get in these cars, they're never...
They don't lock.
There's got to be a recall on this by now.
I don't know.
Did you get the safety recall? I think there's something for the gas tank or something in these.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Because I have a check engine light that has something to do with the gas tank.
I think you need like a shield or something, but that's what they put in ours. I would check the recall history on this.
Something about air getting in or out or something.
Yeah. So yeah, Ford, a little feedback for you. It's actually, like, it's okay in the back. Like, I don't know if it's super spacious. Hold on. You put the seat back?
Yeah. Look, you got space.
Yeah, but that was like with me driving. I'm super short.
Okay.
But it's comfy. Like, yeah. It's comfy back here.
It's two Anthony's comfy.
Yeah, it's two Anthony's comfy. And you know what's cool? I can see out the back. Like, as a driver, like, okay, the C-pillar is a bit of a blind spot, but... Cars in the 90s had way better visibility than vehicles now. Would you agree? You drive a Challenger.
Yes, absolutely.
So how do you visibility-wise, what's your opinion on this versus your Challenger? They're both two-door coupes.
I can see out of this one more. So it's much better. Much better.
Yeah, so cars... Okay, that's why we have all this passive safety now. That's why we have, like, the blind spot detection now and, like, the collision avoidance systems and everything. Because we can't see out of newer vehicles, so we solved it. You just make the windows bigger, and we can get rid of all that stuff.
Well, look just how thin, you know, everything this car is. If it was to roll over, yeah, you're dead. But,
you know, the A-pillars.
These days, they're so much thicker, right? rollover safety.
Like, yeah.
You can see when you're going left, when you're going right.
I'd be interested to see this thing in that test where they drop it on its lid. It probably doesn't do that well. Because, it is a heavy car. Like, and we were talking about this. Like, it's not a very big car. Like, I remember these things, I thought they were huge when I was a kid. And then
it was big when it came out.
Yeah. And then looking at, like, all the new cars, it's not, like, as much as I love Challengers, Challengers look kind of chunky to me.
They are.
And like, this thing's, like, lean, if that's the right word. Like, I guess the proportion, like, the skinny tires and everything makes it look lean. Okay. Well, yeah,
see, it's very easy to get out.
Yeah. All right, let's see the back.
Okay.
Let's see the back.
Profile, or you
want to
see the trunk?
Both. I like this. My Thunderbird had more of a slant. This is like, this reminds me more of like a G-body, like a Buick Grand National, like straight window and really flat trunk.
I've always like preferred the Thunderbird rear over the Mercury rear, but
you like the Ford more than this?
Yeah. Again, it's unique. It's different.
Yeah.
You know.
XR7.
Amazing American trunk.
Which is interesting too. We'll discuss this because this has an independent rear suspension, so it's a very shallow trunk.
It is.
And
it goes pretty long.
Yeah. I remember mine, like I had 210s in a ported box, tucked it back, still had lots of room for groceries. Like these cars I think are great for sound systems. They're very solid. I can't really complain. Like I know we're making fun of the driver's door, but like this car's got 250,000 kilometers on it. This side probably wasn't used that much, but like, people think that sounds clunky and it's like American quality, but like
it is.
But I like it.
Yeah.
I like it. Like,
it makes you feel safe.
Yeah.
Like you're like, okay, it's like a big hug from mom. You know, it's like, oh, that's a safe sound.
Yeah, it's not like, I wouldn't call it, it's not a vault. It's more like a really robust gate. Shutting, like that's what it sounds like to me.
That's true. Yeah.
Like a Mercedes in the 90s sounds like a vault. This is just like, we're just gonna throw a lot of metal at it. I don't know, I like it. And we were mentioning before in the mid 90s and early 2000s, like body cladding, that was so popular back then. Like we want to put a molding on the car to protect it, so we're gonna put a painted molding on to protect the paint, which it does protect the steel, but then you get the same effect after. Like, that's why cars in like the 80s, I think, more were doing it, that the black molding, and then it just kept getting bigger and bigger and bigger. I was hoping you're gonna have the corner lights. This one doesn't have it. I think it's early 90s.
The
light down here when you signal. Turn.
Yeah,
light it up so you can somehow see, like, it would light up like here. And then they would expect you to see this.
I had an early 90s Infiniti that did that.
The light down there?
Yeah, the one based on the Sentra.
I know what you're talking about. The little thing.
Yeah.
The little guy.
Yeah, and it had the light.
Did it work?
Yeah.
Oh, it does work.
Yeah, so when I turned, I actually saw a little bit of light. Kind of, like, it was pointless, but it was cool.
Like, you could see a pedestrian with it?
No, you could just see this kind of area light up a little bit.
Oh, so like, okay, so it just made you feel good.
Yeah, and it was like, hey, that's a cool feature. Yeah, that's useless. Yeah, and it's got one of these, you know, depending how...
That's supposed to be power.
Yeah, but...
It's telescopic.
It's custom now, so you can...
Yeah.
You know, if you want to listen to it, just lift it up, you know, just pop it down.
Okay, so should we put this thing up in the air? Because I think it's more interesting underneath this thing.
Yeah. Especially because I don't know what we're going to find.
Okay. Oh, yeah, you just bought this thing.
You want to talk about the stupid wheels.
What's wrong with the wheels? Okay, you clear?
One size.
It's like all the bolt pattern.
Bolt pattern, yeah.
Yeah, I don't have to talk about that.
It's like Mercury, Thunderbird.
All right, so this is the good part underneath, because I think these cars are pretty interesting. Because look behind, American vehicle with a fully independent rear suspension. And I thought, like, oh, look, it's got a drive shaft safety loop. I'm like, yeah, you need that because if something fails back here because of the fuel tank, you don't want it, like, bouncing around in there. So, I don't know. I think it's just, it's pretty cool. Like, they all do it now. They all have rear suspension setups like this now because they want better handling. They want a better ride. But, like, this car was doing it. Like, when did this car come out? Like, I think 1989, 1990s when this chassis came out. And they were doing it back then. And no one really gives Ford credit for it. Like, I remember Ford was, like, boasting about the 2005 Mustang because it had a Panhard bar. And I don't know why, because the 1986 Camaro and Firebird had the same rear suspension setup way before, and they even had a torque arm. But it's just, it's neat looking at designs back then. And it's got a little bit of a leak.
It's a healthy one.
Yeah. But at the same time, there's no rust.
You gotta remember, this was also lived in Ontario, the beginning of its years. I don't know how long.
Yeah, like there's...
It doesn't look like it was that long, maybe.
There is rust, though. We did notice there's rust in the rocker. Because I guess I'm willing to bet it pools up in there when you're driving.
Probably.
But surprisingly, when I saw that rust, I'm like, okay, let's see underneath. But, like, look at it. Like, maybe this has something to attribute to it. But, like, looking inside here... This is usually where I look, like where moisture and everything's gonna build up. And then I'll look at the pinch seams or the pinch welds. And depending on how the car was serviced, usually they could be crushed in, but like this one's actually looks really good underneath.
It's a two-owner car.
Really?
Yeah, okay. So the people that originally bought it in Ontario drove it here. And then
the kid bought it?
Yeah, then a young guy had it for, I think he said a year and a half.
Okay. And then we were looking at the front suspension. So it's neat because it's similar to my 350. It has a multi-link front suspension, but it has an upper A-arm. So it's not a strut. So like they spent money on this. Like there's more substantial components on this compared, like most newer vehicles are, they'll use a strut. Because it's easier to manufacture, it's easier to design, but it's more expensive for the consumer. So this is pretty neat seeing. And then like there's like extra bracing in here and things like that. Like they added this in here to tie everything together. And surprisingly, like the rack and pinion is very easy to service. I don't really, it's been so long since I've been underneath one of these things. I'm actually very surprised, or pleasantly surprised, how good it looks underneath this vehicle, besides the leak. Like, it's pissing oil. Like, this thing's been here for, like, half an hour.
It leaves its mark around, yeah, that's true.
And, like, this is back in the day where, like, cars had huge overhangs. Like, look at where the front tire starts to the nose of the car. And, like, that was, like, a thing back then. Having big overhangs. My 97 Camaro had huge overhangs. You'd be very careful when you're approaching things. It's hit a couple things here. Like there's some scratch marks, but like it's a stock suspension. It's not lowered.
But usually these things get hacked up.
Like in the cardio world, like they were kind of like, well, it's along the lines of like a G body, like a Regal or Monte Carlo. Like, but it wasn't as popular. Like around where we live, I didn't see people building up Cougars or Thunderbirds. They were always going after the Monte Carlos and the Regals and the Supremes. Yeah. I saw a couple of Grand Prix, but not too many. Just another observation. The drive shaft, for as long as this car is still a single piece. Man, it's tightly packaged under here.
Yeah, it wouldn't be fun replacing one of those.
Yeah, I think you have to drop the tank. It's just, it's funny here too, like, they put this brace here, and the solution back then was just to pinch the pipe in manufacturing as opposed to making another bend. Like, most modern exhaust systems, when I look under the cars, look really nice now. Like, they're like, they look like they're...
Well engineered.
Yeah, they're like, they look like aftermarket systems. Like they're,
yes,
it's all mandrel bent now on newer cars. It looks like they're stainless to some degree, but like most newer vehicles, I'm like, just change the muffler because they're already going to flow good. And then back then, like when cars were designed like this, doing aftermarket exhaust was definitely worth it because look at all that restriction right there.
Yeah.
And this thing would sound probably pretty good.
I think it would, yeah.
Like I'm not a Flowmaster guy, but like you kind of have to put Flowmasters on it. I'm pretty sure you'll triple the value of the vehicle if you put Flowmasters on it.
Where can I find them?
Orco.
Oh, the universal ones.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
What is that?
So every once in a while, you have to drain the trunk fluid, just like the wiper fluid, and or sorry, the blinker fluid.
No, it's got like an actual drain.
Yeah.
How did you open it?
I just pressed it.
I mean, how you close it?
I don't know. I'm pretty sure we just gotta let it finish itself.
Yeah, finish itself, okay.
It's a pretty steady stream.
But I've never... We just opened it, though. We just...
I didn't even open it. I just flipped it.
We just...
Like, I was like, what's this? And then it... It smells like damp car.
But we looked at the trunk. Like, well, we just looked at the trunk.
It's kind of yellowy, too, eh?
Yeah, it's like real pee.
So I want to do more videos of this. We're trying to figure out the flow for this, and I wanted to bring Chris on more because I just, it's just two buddies hanging out, just talking about cars. Very candid, and it's more like garage shop talk, I want to say. Like, we're not doing any how-tos or anything. We're having more of a candid conversation. We're messing around with it more. Like, it's fun. It's almost like it's fun because we don't care about it. Like, would you say, like...
Yeah, no, that's true, yeah.
Like, I'm your Challenger, like... I've never slid across the hood of the Challenger.
No.
But, like, newer cars, like, we're talking, like... They don't have, like... When you see a big hood like this, it just screams, like, slide across me. Like, that's what it says.
No, I see, I get what you're saying, yeah.
Maybe I watch too much Dukes of Hazzard, but I don't know, like... I don't know, comment below, guys, like... Do you want to see more candid videos like this, like trying to like do what we did with the live streams, but it's uninterrupted? Or do you guys want to see this in the live stream format? I kind of want to know because like I just have fun just talking about the car and kind of examining it. It's something that we've always done, but we've never actually videoed it before. So comment below, guys, and tell me if you want to see that.